Flying saucers, creatures from another planet, unidentified flying objects. In the next hour, we'll hear from people who have had close encounters with extraterrestrials. Close encounters of the first, second, third, even the fourth kind. The most common is a close encounter of the first kind, which is defined as the sighting of an unidentified flying object, an object that can't be explained by conventional means.
It was just a red flashing light.
It sounded like a swishing sound, sort of.
Et alors autour de cette forme, il y avait des petites lucioles rouges.
I saw this big triangular shaped three lights on each corner coming over my house.
Mysterious lights in the sky. They were like the stars.
It just like was sliding through the sky and it tilted like it was looking down at us.
It was a bright light that dimmed down to a white speck and went back to a red light, down to a white speck and then just disappeared.
Last year, there were almost 4,000 reported UFO sightings in the United States, 2,000 in South America, more than 1,000 in Asia, and over 3,000 in the Soviet Union. The worldwide total was over 10,000. UFO investigators wonder why those numbers have increased dramatically in the past 45 years. Does the publicity of one person seeing a UFO spark the imagination of others who are eager to believe? Or has the Air Force simply increased its testing of military hardware? These are difficult questions to answer without tracing the UFO story. Let's start at the beginning. Cave art in Australia and the Western United States, painted at least 5,000 years ago by prehistoric civilizations, seems to resemble modern descriptions of creatures from outer space. Halfway around the world, a 13th century fresco inside a church in Yugoslavia includes a flying vehicle. It would be another 700 years before technology made flight possible. The modern age of UFOs began in 1947. Ex-military pilot Kenneth Arnold was flying his plane over the Cascade Mountain Range. He encountered several objects traveling at an extreme rate of speed. Although there are no photographs, Arnold had a drawing made of what he saw. His sighting triggered hundreds more that year across the United States. UFO mania reached a fever pitch in the summer of that year when the Army Air Force reported recovering a crashed saucer in New Mexico. The next day, the government claimed the disc was only the wreckage of a weather balloon. Meanwhile, sightings by credible witnesses continued. Commercial airline pilots saw things.
We immediately decided it could not be a comet.
Military pilots saw things.
When we got within 2 miles of the light, we lost all contact.
Local sheriffs in Dexter, Michigan saw things.
Well, there was somewhat of an oval shape, looked like a toy top.
Sightings of unexplained phenomena weren't limited to just the United States. Marina Popovich, a Soviet pilot with over 100 airspeed and endurance records to her credit, had her first UFO encounter in the mountains of southern Russia.
После того, как я увидела шар, который зигзагообразно летел.
My first contact with a UFO was a rather special experience. It was in the mountains, and I saw a sharp ray coming out of a huge sparkling ball.
Even some of the men and women who have been in space have reported seeing things they can't explain. Gemini and Apollo astronaut James McDivitt had his own encounter in June of 1966. While in orbit above the Earth, an unidentified object outside the window caught his attention.
I happened to glance out one time, and there against the black sky was a white object. Geometry of it was sort of like a beer can or a Coke can with a pencil sticking out one of the round edges at about a 45-degree angle.
What was it? McDivitt was able to snap a few pictures, but after turning the film over to NASA, the photographs disappeared. He suggests it's conceivable that other civilizations could have the technological know-how to make space travel possible. And he's not alone in this belief. A 1990 Gallup poll showed that nearly 50% of Americans believe in the existence of UFOs. This despite the fact that most photographs and film footage of the actual sightings are not very good. The images are scratched, out of focus, or the camera's just too far away to see things clearly. But with the advent of the home video camera, more and more people have captured unexplained phenomena on tape. This home video was shot over Las Vegas in early 1991. It shows three objects floating and diving in front of the mountains.
Yeah, this is a spectacular maneuver. As you say, it goes in front of the mountains. It has the mountain as a backdrop, which gives you a fairly good idea of its distance.
In Gulf Breeze, Florida, something that looks like a spacecraft was caught floating just above the tree line. Videos like this have convinced quite a few Gulf Breeze residents that UFOs are real. A small town located just across the bridge from Pensacola, it's been one of the busiest places in the United States for UFO sightings since 1987.
And we have over 500 witnesses, and we have about 262 recorded sightings, and we've investigated almost 200 of those.
The investigations have been conducted by a small group of Gulf Breeze residents. Most are members of MUFON, the Mutual UFO Network, a grassroots national organization of private citizens who've taken it upon themselves to try to get to the bottom of the UFO mystery. One possible explanation has surfaced. Gulf Breeze is virtually surrounded by three major military bases, all with extensive air traffic.
We call the military. We're told, no, we did not have anything in the area at the time that you had your sighting. Of course, there will be those that say, well, that's the typical military response. Even if there was something going on, they would deny it.
The wave of sightings in Gulf Breeze started with this man, Ed Walters. In November of 1987, Ed and his wife, Frances, took some amazing photographs of a flying saucer. Fearing ridicule, at first Ed kept the pictures to himself, but then he sent them to the Gulf Breeze Sentinel, the local newspaper. Publisher Duane Cook knew his reputation would be on the line if he decided to print the pictures.
I was nervous, naturally, and my folks came in Wednesday afternoon while we're putting the paper together. And I said, you're not going to believe what we're getting ready to run in this week's paper. Showed them the pictures, and they looked at them and said, that's what we saw. So at that point, I more or less lost my fear of going with it because, you know, if your own folks see it, if you can't trust them, who can you trust?
As it turns out, at least a dozen other people saw the same thing that night, including Art Hufford and several other people who then became members of MUFON.
I never felt more alone than I felt that day, November the 11th, 1987, seeing this thing, and then later, nobody saying very much, and then, of course, several weeks later, you know, people were coming forward, and fortunately, you came forward a month later and said, hey, I saw that same thing.
Dr. Bruce McAbee, an expert photo analyst employed by the Navy with over 20 years' experience, spent several months studying the Walters pictures. McAbee also had Walters use a stereo Polaroid camera the next time he saw something.
Some of his early photos contemplated the possibility that they were hoaxed by a double exposure method, but there is a question of whether or not anybody knows how to photo, how to fake stereo pictures and do it well. I concluded that doing the photography, if it was a hoax, combined with all the other sightings, the testimony of Ed and his family, the intensive investigation, all ruled out the possibility that this was a hoax. And so I concluded in late May of 1988 that it was real.
Since 1987, South Shoreline Park has become a magnet for sky watching. The sky watchers have been able to videotape several unidentified objects. Most of them look like nothing more than small points of light in the sky. But close examination has revealed that the lights are doing something that science says is impossible. They move at odd angles, change size, travel at unheard of speeds, all while never making a sound.
One of the more recent videos shows a light that was red and all of a sudden it turns white and starts flashing. These extremely brilliant pulses of light. It appears that it's as if the actual size of the image, which would be related to the size of the light source itself, changed in like 1/30th of a second or so from one TV frame to the next. We don't have anything that could do that, so far as I know.
While the encounters continue in Florida, the most recent UFO observations have occurred thousands of miles away in Belgium. An amateur photographer videotaped this triangular-shaped object in early 1991. Last year, there were 500 sightings in all of Europe. So far this year, reports in Belgium alone have totaled over 3,500.
C'est un qui volait d'abord tout doucement, donc on le voyait avancer de cette manière-ci, et puis tout d'un coup.
From prehistoric cave art to medieval frescoes to videotapes in Florida and Belgium, people have been recording strange things they've seen in the skies. What are they? Perhaps the answer lies out beyond the stars. At this point, just out of our reach. In July of 1991, astronomers reported the discovery of a planet 10 times the size of Earth, orbiting a star 30,000 light years away. If the finding is confirmed, it will be the first planet detected outside our solar system. Could it be possible we're not the only living beings in the universe? And while we're watching the skies, we wonder if someone might be watching us.